How are you? Welcome again to More American Cooking, and today we're going to do sourdough bread. How do I get that as American? Well, let me tell you. We really don't know who first invented bread. The Egyptians claim that they had raised bread the first time in the world. I don't think that's the case. You see, what they were really using was what we now call a sourdough. That is to say, they were yeasts that were wild on the desert, or fermented yeasts that came with them. Now, this didn't happen until after the arrival of the Jews in Egypt. And when the Jews left, remember, they left the sourdough behind and were baking flat, unleavened cakes in the desert called matzahs. Now, my theory is that the Jews brought the yeast in the first place, the sourdough yeast. It is a yeast, you see, a wild yeast in the desert. They brought it in the first place, and somehow the Egyptians got credit for it. Scholars are still arguing about that, but this scholar thinks the Jews should have gotten credit, and the Egyptians whipped it up after the Jews left and went back to Canaan. In any case, the theory is simple. What you do, once you get a sourdough starter going or yeast dough going, you save a little of the batter each day and add it to the batter the next day so that the old yeast will leaven the new dough. Remember that from biblical lines? And if it have a bad leavening, it'll make the whole dough bad. That's how they used to talk about people in the community. The same thing when you talk about one rotten apple in the barrel, you see, it will infect the whole works. Well, that's exactly how sourdough works. And we're going to talk about how we can get one started today. How did they get to the New World? Believe it or not, there's a theory that claims that Columbus, Christopher Columbus brought some sourdough starter with him because that's the way you baked in the old days. You see, you didn't have dried yeast cakes or instant yeast. You used sourdough starters. You had to have some of the old dough in order to leaven the new. So he brought it to the New World, supposedly. We do know that as recent as the 1890s in California, the old Alaska miners would always take their sourdough with them. As a matter of fact, they kept it with them constantly and lived on the stuff, and eventually they were called sourdoughs. My granddad was a sourdough, and I'll tell you about him later on. Here's what you do to make a sourdough. If you want, whoa, look at this one. It's crawling right. I'm sorry. I think we have some very serious heat here in my kitchen. Some from the light, some from the stove. But I've got to stir this down before it attacks. This one looks like Jabba the Hutt. It's going to crawl out of the bowl and get me. This is my basic batter. And I'll show you how to do that. First of all, you need a starter. And they claim that you can make a starter just by mixing water and flour and sugar together and then letting it sit for 2 or 3 days, and it will eventually begin to ferment. But I think you need to get a purer starter than that. So some say you can use yogurt, too. Put a little bit of yogurt in some flour, water, and sugar and let it sit for 2 or 3 days, and it'll begin to bubble up. But what I want to do is to make a legitimate starter for you. Now, I've done a little bit of study about this because it's important that we understand that people can keep a starter for up to 50 years. These are Alaskans, of course. Now all Alaskans are called sourdoughs because this is so much a part of their tradition. But I have found a bakery that has brought in sourdough starter from San Francisco. It's called Bodine. It is a sourdough bakery, a wonderful place. And they're busy baking for us right now here in Chicago. This is Bus, the old baker, and he's showing me the mother. That's the starter dough. And the odor, whew, I tell you, it is absolutely sour. I was shocked by the odor. Tim is taking out 800 pounds of dough that has been leavened with the mother, or the sourdough that originally came from San Francisco a few years ago when this branch of the Bodine Bakery opened. A lot of machinery involved here, but please understand that there's a theory that says that if sourdough isn't touched by human hands, it's really not going to work. So in the midst of all of this, machinery, every dough is handled, every loaf is handled and patted and blessed at least 10 times. And they have some funky machinery. Look at this one for rolling rolls, for making rolls. Isn't that marvelous? That's an old, old German machine. I love it. Finally, the bread is put in the rising room, and it's baked, and the odors that come from this bakery are simply marvelous. I love it. And what I want to do today with you is to, it smells so good, is to show you how to make a starter, a mother, you see, and then basically a batter, and then eventually get into your own sourdough cooking. It's really not at all complicated. I love this stuff. You know, there's an old guy in San Francisco years ago who supposedly would pick up a ball of dough. He was down in a basement, and the walls were covered with fungus, with mildew that had been in that bakery for years, and the yeasts were kind of interchangeable. And they claimed he made the best bread in San Francisco. And he'd take a ball of dough. He had no shirt on. It was very hot in that old basement. And he'd grab a ball of dough, and he'd roll it around, and he'd bang it on his chest, big hairy chest, and he'd wham it on the pan, and into the oven it would go. The health department shut him down, claiming that it was unsanitary. Of course it was not. Bread is baked at high temperatures. And everyone in town heard that he was no longer banging the bread on his chest. And to this day, they claim, the days of really good bread are gone. Now, part of that is probably mythological, maybe legendary at best. But it is true that, at least I believe, that you've really got to touch the dough. Too many machines aren't going to work. So let's make a basic starter. I'm going to purchase somewhere in here. There's a little bitty package of a starter, and this comes from San Francisco. It's called the Gold Rush Company. If you can't find this in your community, you might be able to find another brand, but I'm particularly fond of this stuff. It really works very, very well. And in the packet, here it is, in the packet they'll have instructions for all sorts of things. So I'm going to make a few of those dishes, and then I'll show you a few of mine. First of all, the starter itself. And the starter, look at this. I've got to stir these down again. They're just crawling all over the place. I had these all ready for you just as you arrived, but this one's beginning to burp up all over the place. It's fun to do this, and it's great fun to watch the kids' eyes get bigger and bigger and bigger as they see that yeast is really a living thing. Now, Patty won't touch this. My wife won't touch this kind of cooking because she says, I never cook something that's alive, and it is alive. There is a microorganism that digests the natural sugar in the wheat, and in that digestion produces a gas, CO2. Yeast always does that. And thus we have fermentation. And with that, the rising of the loaf, the odor in the house, and the blessing by grandma, and the whole works. All right, let's make a starter. First of all, I need a bowl, and we're going to add, what does he say? He wants 2 cups of flour and 2 cups of warm water. Now, by warm, he means tepid. Tepid means you put your finger in it, and it isn't hot, and it isn't cold. It is exactly warm. So you put 2 cups of water in the bowl and dissolve in that the starter. This is better than, for me, it's a lot easier than trying those methods that, I should have cut this open sooner than this. There we go. It's a lot easier than trying the chance method. This takes all of the chance out of it. And as far as I'm concerned, cooking shouldn't involve a lot of chance. You should have a good time. Stir the little packet of sourdough starter into your water. 2 cups of water, 2 cups of flour, and we have a basic, at least a beginning mother, you see? There we are. That's the mother. Now, this must sit about 12 hours before anything will happen. You've got to wake the stuff up. You know, it's been dormant for a while. It's been sitting around a little plastic sack. All right. Now, that's the basic starter. And you let this ferment, and after a while, it will begin to bubble and spit and do wonderful things. There. Well, let me show you some that have been bubbling and spitting. Look at this one. Look at this. Calm down. Stop it. This is my job of the hut. That's really a little bit heavy. But this really will keep rising. Once you get it started, after about 12 hours, you just put this in the refrigerator, and the cold will make it calm down. So we now have the starter. Got that? It will calm down. You could buy little fancy crocks to put this in too if you want. It comes with a bit of a batter, you see, and a little crock to seal it, and they can refrigerate that. But I don't think you really need one of these. Fully on the crock, just use an old plastic container. But do keep it covered and refrigerated, and then you'll have no trouble with it. All right, so we have a basic starter. We've allowed that to ferment for a while. Now, tomorrow I'm going to bake bread, so the night before, I make a batter. Got that? Here we go with the batter. It isn't half as complicated as you think. The basic batter, in this case, this one is climbing all over the counter here. It's the heat. I love it. Look at it. Isn't that wonderful? Bloop, bloop, bloop. I think it's just colossal. And this is so old. We're talking about the old way of baking breads. Just keep using the batter over and over again. All right. Now he wants me to make a basic batter. And the batter is very, very simple. We're going to put 1.5 cups of flour and 1.5 cups of water together and mix in some of our batter. The instructions are very plain, and you simply go over and over again on this. So here we go. We're going to start today with sourdough French bread. I have some of these torn up here. Let's find this one. Here we go. We'll start with sourdough French bread. The first thing we have to do is to make our batter out of the starter and let that ferment for a time. So we make 2 cups of proofed sourdough batter. And that simply means that you add another 1.5 cups of flour and 1.5 cups of water together, mix it up, and then you blend in your starter. Let me just do that quickly. And that's how you keep things going. All right, here's our starter. Look at that. Isn't that a kick? I just love it. And we add another 1.5 cups of tepid water. There we go. Not too hot. There we are. And 1.5 cups of flour. That's 1.5. Now, whip that up. I would put that on my mixer, you see. I have a good mixer here somewhere. Here we go. A whipper. But I put that in my electric mixer. And mix that all up. Then at the end of this time, this is what you use for starting your dough. And then you put some of this back into the container and keep it for the next day or the next week, whatever you'd like to do. You see? Mix all of this up, and you now have the basic batter. You got that? Now, here's what we do in order to make, for instance, a basic French bread. Using some of the batter. Boy, flour all over the place already, and we're just getting started. Using some of the basic batter, we want to add, let's see, which is an open one here? Here we go. I want 2 cups of proofed sourdough dough. That means that you make the basic batter with the starter, let it sit overnight, and it will begin to bubble up. You now double your quantity. So you measure out 2 cups. Boy, look at this one. Measure out 2 cups of the batter. This one is already batter. You see, I've mixed it up twice. Save the rest. That goes into your bowl. And that's how we begin the whole operation. We're also going to add some yeast to this, because we want to do this rather quickly. The sourdough flavor is already in the mother. That's what's in the pan now. This is the mother, and it already has that sour flavor. But we're going to add a little bit of yeast as well. So I need 1 package of yeast into 1 cup of tepid water. This isn't half as complicated as you think. Don't let your water get too hot. Tepid means you don't worry much about it when you put your finger in there. Oh, there's a cup of water.